And the sheet you wear upon your face is the sheet your children sleep on. And every night you say a prayer you don't believe, but still you keep on. And your money says in God we trust, but it's against the law to pray in school. You say we beat the Russians to the moon, and I say you starved your children to do it. You say all men are equal, all men are brothers, then why are the rich more equal than others? If you're looking for the answer, I've only got one. That a man leaves his darkness when he follows the sun. Great song. Larry was a broken boy who was in the middle of a revolution. He was the first real rock and roller that identified himself as Christian. He wrote an album that skyrocketed, and then as a Christian now, he wrote a second album that was banned by the church. It's called So Long Ago in the Garden. That's one of my favorite albums ever. He ended up living in and passed away in Salem, Oregon, which is just down south of us in Portland. When I wrote The Shack, I violated all kinds of intellectual property rights because I didn't know any better. I mean, I did. And so we ended up, because I quoted people, right? And so I ended up violating intellectual property rights. I didn't know about intellectual property rights. I didn't know, I never intended to be published. So I get a call from Larry's brother, Matt, I think. And he goes, Paul, I know you're running into some issues with intellectual property rights. Just let me tell you, we love The Shack. And anytime in the future, ever, for the rest of your life, you want to quote Larry, you have our permission. So it was really sweet. So that tells you some of the legacy that's from the heart of inside the Norman family. What's my topic?
You matter.
Oh, that's great. You matter. That's what I said. I didn't mean it as a question. I apologize. If you fall asleep, don't feel bad. I would like to extend the rest of Jesus to you. We're designed to live and work from rest, not toward it. And that's one of the big things that changes for us as we begin to understand who we are. I love story, and I love story because I think every single human being is one. And it's an epic story. And when you get invited into people's stories, you get invited into holy ground. Because that's where you get to see dirt and fire that doesn't consume anything living in the same spot. And I tell people, I think the reason we're born without shoes is because we're intended to walk on holy ground. And I think story does that. Story is such an invitation into space and you get to watch and see the activity of God in another human being's life. And The Shack, we made 15 copies at Office Depot and for Christmas. And those 15 copies did everything I wanted it to do. And, six to the kids, and Kim got a copy, and the rest I gave to my friends. I went back to work, not crossing my mind one time to publish this thing. So the fact that it's now this phenomenon internationally is well within God's sense of humor, let me tell you. And I'm very grateful to be a part of that, participate. There are things that people get out of that book I never wrote. But I'm sure God says that about the Bible too, so. And I love it. I love that, it's part of the beauty of fiction is it creates a space that people can hear it for themselves. And this is Baxter's line, he loves it, because in Mississippi, he'll have, Elton John will come to a concert, and you'll have Presbyterian elders waving their arms and holding cigarette lighters, right? Because they're caught up in the fact that here is a man who participates in the wonder and the creativity of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, to whatever degree he doesn't know it. There's degrees that I obviously don't know it. Right? And I've gotten to participate. And how cool is that? Probably 95% of all books I sign, I'll end up at the bottom writing, You Matter. Because I think that's one of the biggest single lies that we get constantly fed all the time, is that you don't matter. You don't matter. You're just one of a big number. And, you know, when I'm in countries that are in Asia and stuff like this, and you've got, you know, a billion people or whatever, the sense of not mattering is profound. And if you don't know that you matter, suddenly you don't think that anything you do matters. And I believe everything you do actually matters. This is why the little elderly blue-haired ladies who are in their prayer closets praying for things, someday, mark my words, I can say this very easily, because I'm convinced it's true. So someday, we will see the tapestry of where this elderly little lady prayed this prayer and it changed the cosmos. And we'll be able to see those threads that are woven. And I love that.
Yes.
And so some of you may know this story already. I'm going to tell you the story of my mom. You guys know this one? Cool. But this is an example of one. The one matters. If you read Crossroads, you know about Cabbie. And Cabbie is based 100% on Nathan Breedeveld, who we just celebrated his graduation into the cloud of witnesses 6 years ago, just recently. Nathan is a Down syndrome boy, and I built Cabbie's character 100% off of Nathan Breedeveld. So there is an absolute nonfiction character of a real character in Crossroads, juxtaposed against Tony, who seems to have his life in order in terms of success and everything, but he's an absolute wreck on the inside, where Cabbie, his body is a wreck, and his genetics is a wreck, but his life on the inside is fully alive, right? And so you have this juxtaposition. And so I'm talking to Nathan's mom, Pam, who's a therapist, and I'm talking to her about a book that she's writing that helps children through games learn how to stay safe, right, just through games. And so I'm talking to Pam, and she's asking me about the book. She wants to talk to me because now that I'm a published author, I know everything. So, yeah, ask me. Global warming, quantum theory. I know, because I have a platform now. Such ridiculous stuff. So she says, and you know this. You know that there are moments where the Holy Spirit goes out of, and I say her because I'm basing it on the Old Testament Ruach, which is feminine. Right? And it kind of breaks people's paradigms so that we can get the maternal feminine nature of God back into the character and being of God. Right? And in fact, I am way more comfortable referring to the Holy Spirit as she as he. But it doesn't mean any more that the Holy Spirit is female any more than it means that God as Father is male. Because all of maleness, all of femaleness derives from the nature and character of God. But there are times, and you know this in your experience, where you're talking to somebody and you're saying things you've never heard before, right? And you're thinking, I need to listen to this, like, you know, right? So, and you're saying things like, and you know that that person's at that moment thinking you are the most brilliant human being on the planet. That's the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit is always making everyone around her look great. Right? And this is that's why the Holy Spirit was often referred to as the light in which the Father and Son love one another. It's this the humility of God, the lighting, right? You know, when you don't, and again, Baxter, you look at a monument or a building, you're not going like, oh my, unless you are a lighting person, you're not going like, oh my gosh, look at that lighting. You know, you're thinking, look at that monument or that building. I'm talking to Pam and one of those brilliant things comes out of my mouth, right? And she's saying about this book, asking about it, and I said, let me ask you a question. If the net result of all your blood, sweat, and tears writing this book, the net result is that it impacts the life of one person, will that be enough? And I love Pam, partly because she's authentic and honest. And she says, no. And which is the honest answer for most people, right? Because that's not how they think about these kind of things. And I said, well, then you don't understand the value of the one. And you wouldn't have left the 99 just to go find the one. And she went, wow. She went, oh my gosh, that is such a plank upside the head, right? Which is, and I never said that to a human being before in this conversation. So you understand that I'm like, wow. Like, that was brilliant, you know? Because it's true. Because Jesus will leave the 99 for the one, and you're the one, and I'm the one. So this is a story about the one, and this is a story also that kind of wraps this dual thread together, which is God is good all the time. He is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Right, John, 1 John 1. And he's good all the time. Now, it took me a lot of years to believe that, because he was good or not so good depending on me, the way I grew up. So if I was doing all the right stuff, then he was good. But then if, you know, I just couldn't trust him to be good all the time. And you can't. You cannot trust someone that you don't believe is good all the time. You're going to start withdrawing and hesitating, and it's just because you got to stay safe. And you can't trust someone who you don't believe loves you. Right? So you'll start creating survival mechanisms and skills. The other part, the other thread is this God who is good all the time is involved in the details of your lives, but does it in such a way to not become a new abuser or coercive or, right? This God does not rip out of your hands even the survival mechanisms that kept you alive as a child, even though they prevent you from authentic relationships now. Not until you're ready to let him go does he take it. And that is an arduous process for some of us, because those things did keep us alive as children, in some sense. So, this is a story that wraps those two things together. My dad has helped thousands of people. If you look at his impact, he's had significant impact. And as a pastor, as a missionary, as whatever. But all of that doesn't balance out the damage and the hurt and all those kinds of things. They're two different conversations about the same human being. And you could say the same thing about my life. People ask me, you know, would you go back and change anything in your past knowing the kind of things that are happening now in the shack and all this? And I say, absolutely. I'd go back and stop every time I hurt other people. I would. And if that meant no shack, none of this, I'm good with that. Right? I have regrets about the things that I broke. You know, even though I was broken, I broke things. And you learn how to embrace that in, and it becomes part of who you are, and your story, and your song now. But I'd change it if I could. When the shack came out, it surprised a whole bunch of people. When it actually got printed, which was in 07. I wrote it for Christmas of 05. And then I went back to work, and it took a while for it to trickle into relationships. The first real conversation about printing it had to do with it becoming a movie. And that was a wild, crazy idea. So, which continues to today. So, who knows? But it is an ongoing conversation, and they look like they just signed Octavia Spencer to play Papa and all kinds of stuff. When the book first hit the market, and I'm working my three jobs, thinking like, this is interesting, you know? And it starts taking off. The big first thing that it surprised people was that Papa was a large black African-American woman. Papa, God the Father, right? And one of the people that caught sideways was my mom. So as much as I didn't know whether my dad had read the book, I knew my mom tried to read the book. Because her son wrote a book, and her beautician was telling her about it, and her doctor was telling her about it. And she figured, I better read the book, right? So she tried. She really gave it her best shot. And when Papa came through the door, she shut the book. And she picked up the phone, and she called Debbie, my sister. And these are my mom's exact words. Debbie, your brother is a heretic. Right? Because she's like, this is my mom, who's a missionary, right, to New Guinea, right? And she's going like, no, he's totally gone off the deep end here. And which is, she got stuck right there. Let me tell you how my mom got unstuck. Because this is one of those stories about the weaver, you know, God being the weaver. And how God works inside the details of our lives. My mother is a registered nurse. She went into nurse's training as an 18-year-old, single woman, in Victoria Jubilee Hospital, Victoria, British Columbia. So just across from Vancouver, take the ferry across, you know. So it was a 3-year nurse's program, and this is 1946 that she enters nurse's training. 1946, there was God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and doctors. Not necessarily in that order. And some of you are elderly enough to know the days when the doctor profession was a holy profession. You never countermanded a doctor, you never disagreed with a doctor, they were all men, they wore white, so you knew they were holy. And literally, if they stepped on a pathway, everybody vacated and let them by. If they walked in a chart room, everybody stood up until they were done. Because they dealt with life and death stuff, and I'm convinced that nurses exist to protect us from doctors, but that's just a whole other story. And I got friends who are doctors, so that's all good. Some of them are women, too, just so you know. But my mom goes, she's 18 years old, inside this, and back in 1946, there's no NICU, there's no neonatal. You know, the state of the art back then, at best, the state of the art for little babies that were premature, which they didn't survive if they were premature, but for even infants that were struggling was these little chicken incubator kind of things, that they were sort of like, that was the state of the art. So, there's a family in Victoria that were trying to have a baby, a husband and wife, Reverend and Mrs. Munn, M-U-N-N. And Reverend Munn was the senior pastor of the Anglican Church in Victoria. And their chart showed that they had 5 late second trimester, early third trimester miscarriages in a row. 5 in a row that they'd been trying to have a baby, and their baby would survive, and then something would go sideways, right? And I know some of that kind of loss. We had a baby, one of our grandbabies, Malcolm, last summer. Our son Nicholas and his wife Renee were having their first baby, and she lost her amniotic fluid partway through her pregnancy, and Malcolm tried to stay inside the uterus for about 2 weeks or more before she finally gave birth naturally, but he did not open his eyes on this side of the bed. Right? So sometimes when I say we have 8 grandchildren, those are the living grandchildren, I know that we have at least one. And I'm sure when we get there, we're going to find out that there were a lot of babies conceived that they didn't make it, right? And some of them we were just not aware of. And so it's going to be quite interesting when we actually see. Because I think every baby that's conceived, God has participated, regardless of what the genetics that that husband and that wife or that man and that woman, and what their motives or intentions were. God has such great respect for human beings that he says, all right, I'm giving this baby life. You brought your genetics, you brought your history, you brought your environmental damage, you brought all this to the table. I'm giving this baby life. That's part of the beauty. So I go through some of these moments with, like, even with Malcolm, you know, Malcolm wasn't even a pound. Right? So Reverend and Mrs. Munn decided that they're going to try one more time to have a baby, and they got pregnant. My mom's been working at the hospital for 3 months, in the nurse's training program for 3 months as an 18-year-old, when Mrs. Munn comes into the hospital bleeding, and she's 6.5 months pregnant with her 6th baby. And they immediately say, we need to call OBGYN, the head of OB, and he's going to come in. He examines her and says, we're going to have to take the baby because it's the mother's life's in danger at this point. So he sets up an emergency C-section, and he grabs the head nurse to assist, who happened to be on duty, but he needed an assist. So he grabs a student nurse to assist, to learn, and to do the cleanup. Guess who? My mom. So 18 years old, 3 months in the nurse's training, and my mother says she had just gotten her cap after 3 months, which means that she looked cooler, but didn't know anything, right? And so she is pulled into this emergency C-section as an 18-year-old. The doctor delivers a 1-pound baby boy. And 1-pound babies do not survive in 1946. Not only that, it's a boy. And boys even struggle much more than girls to stay alive as preemies. Girls are stronger. Boys struggle. So this is a 1-pound baby boy. So the doctor puts this baby boy into a kidney tray, hands him to my mother, and says, it's not viable, dispose of it. Which means incinerator. Because back in the day, that's what you did with medical waste. You put it in the incinerator. And he goes back to finish the operation, and my mother's looking at this little baby boy, and he's still breathing. And she doesn't know what to do. So she walks out into the service area trying to figure out, what do I do? And she's got this little baby boy, and he's breathing, and she's like, I cannot put this baby in the incinerator. I can't do it, but I can't disobey the doctor. So she comes up with a plan. So she finds a washcloth, wraps this baby boy in a washcloth, puts him back inside the kidney tray. And if you know anything about preemies too, they don't make a lot of noise, right? That's just one of the signs of the premature, is that they don't have a voice yet. So puts him back in the kidney tray, walks back in the operating room, and puts him on top of the sterilization unit because it's the only warm place in the room. What's her plan? Baby's gonna die. As soon as baby dies, I'll obey the doctor. But I'm not going to put a living, breathing baby boy in the incinerator. Not going to happen, right? She doesn't say anything to the doctor. Doctor thinks it's all been taken care of. He finishes the operation and leaves. The head nurse takes Mrs. Munn to post-op for recovery. And leaving my mother to do the cleanup. And that's what she does. She does a cleanup, and then she sits in this operating room holding this little baby boy waiting for him to die. So that she can obey the doctor. That baby was delivered 8:30 p.m. May the 30th, 1946. At 9:30, the doctor meets with Reverend and Mrs. Munn and gives them the bad news. Because Mrs. Munn is now out of anesthetics and so she's conscious, and so the doctor comes in to talk to him and said, I'm so sorry. You had a son, but he wasn't viable, and he did not survive. So they are now grieving their sixth child loss. And the doctor goes home because he's done his part. And at 9:30 when he's talking to the parents, my mom's still sitting in the operating room holding this baby waiting for him to die. 10:30, 11:30, 12:30, 1:30 in the morning, my mother says to herself, I should probably tell somebody about this. Baby's not dying, right? So she calls the head nurse who assisted in the operation and tells her, this is what I did. And the head nurse's response, we're in so much trouble, but has to call the doctor. The doctor comes rushing in from home and he is furious. He is livid and he rips into this insubordinate, that's the term that was used, 18-year-old girl who would countermand what he had told her to do. And because of her insubordination and rebellious heart or whatever, she had now put him and the hospital in a situation. So the doctor rips into this little girl, 18 years old, and just takes her apart and says, you created this problem, it is now your problem, but don't you dare say anything to the parents. And everybody is on code of silence. Well, my mother takes the little baby up to the nursery and they begin feeding him with an eyedropper, the nurses, around the clock, right, and holding this little baby. What's the doctor thinking? The doctor thinks the baby's going to die. And as soon as the baby dies, it's over. Nobody has to be the wiser, the parents never have to be told, right? Code of silence. The baby over the next 2 days loses 4 ounces, which also happens with preemies. So this baby drops a quarter body weight down to 12 ounces. And then begins to pick up weight. And the doctor realizes, I better tell the parents sooner than later. So he goes back to the parents and he says, you know, we didn't want to give you any false hope. We thought when your son was delivered that he would immediately pass away, and we don't think he's going to survive. And if he did, he would have brain damage, and he would have MS or complications from being so premature. But due to the miracles of modern medicine, we have managed to keep him alive and sustain him. At that point, you think the parents care. What? But they don't know anything about my mother's involvement at this point at all. They don't care. They have a son. And they name him Harold. Harold Munn. Harold is the word that means good tidings or good news. Good news. Right? And the nurses work with, hold Harold, work with Harold around the clock. 2 weeks later, Mrs. Munn went home. Because that's in the day, you know, you spent 2 weeks there, especially C-section. Mrs. Munn goes home. 2 months later, little tiny Harold goes home to his parents. And 2 years later, my mother, along with a bunch of the other nurses, get an invitation to Harold's second birthday party. Now, in that space of those 2 years, and we found this out later, that Harold's parents have been now asking the doctor in the hospital, like, what really happened here? I mean, this is like 2 days, you know, and you didn't tell us, and nobody will say anything. Nobody answers them about the mystery of Harold's birth, nothing, right? But the nurses are involved, and they know my mom had participated in the operation, and she had been part of the staff that took care of Harold, so she gets invited with the others. And she goes, because she hasn't heard how Harold's doing. And she's really curious. So she goes, and she says, we're sitting there having our cake and whatever, and there's all these little kids running around, and I'm thinking, okay, so where's Harold? And suddenly I realize, that's Harold. It's a little boy. She said he was a little skinny. That's the only thing she said about the way he looked. But he was racing around and running with the other kids. Like, nothing. My mother says nothing. She graduates later that year, moves to Central Canada, goes to Bible school, where she meets my dad. Okay? Do you see those two streams coming together? They get, you know, we do this whole thing. I'm a year old, I'm born in Alberta, we moved to the other side of the world, Highlands of New Guinea, where I grew up. When we come back to Canada, I was almost 10 years old, so first, basically, 9 years of my life as a child, I lived in the Highlands and then boarding school. And so we come back to Canada, and my father becomes an itinerant pastor, and we move around a lot. 13 schools before I graduate high school. And we end up in northern BC, just south of the Alaskan Panhandle, in a little town called Terrace, BC, 90 miles inland from Prince Rupert. So just south of Ketchikan. And that's where I graduated high school. I'm 17 years old, graduating high school. My mom's working at the hospital in Terrace. And one day, my mother reads an obituary in an Anglican newsletter in the Terrace hospital. And it says it's an obituary for a Bishop Munn who had passed away. And she's a little curious. So she happens to be working with an Anglican nurse. Did you know Bishop Munn? And this Anglican nurse says, yeah, very well, actually, worked with him in some of the First Nations tribal situations, incredible human being, but I knew him quite well. My mother's still not sure. Did he have any children? She said, yes, one son. Do you know where that son is? This gal says, you know, no. Now, Harold was born in 46. I'm born in 55, right? So he's 9 years older than me. And so I'm 17. But she says, you know, kind of an amazing boy. Graduated college when he's like 15. And last I heard, he's a missionary teacher in West Africa. My mother still says nothing. Not for 10 more years. 10 years later, I'm now 27. I'm living in Portland, Oregon. I've met Kim. We've gotten married. We have a couple kids. My mother reads another obituary. I'm kind of understanding that. It comes to a point where you just want to make sure you're not in them, you know? So my mom reads another, guess who died?
The doctor.
Yes, the doctor. The doctor that got so mad at her. This is the first time that we, her own family, found out about Harold Mum. She had kept this a secret the whole time. She had never told another person. I'm 27 years old. It's the first time I hear this story. But now that the doctor's dead and he ain't coming back. My mother made sure, you know, wait until he's involved, you know. And that puts up a really big barrier. So she now, the doctor's dead, it's sort of open season, so she decides to track Harold down, and she found him. He was now the senior pastor of the Anglican Church in Victoria, BC, just down the road from where his father pastored in 1946. And for 6 months, my mother stews about telling Harold. Here's her issue. How do I tell Harold the truth about his birth without him thinking that I'm looking for credit? How does she tell him? Finally, at Christmas, she writes him this beautiful letter and wraps his story inside the Christmas story, or the story of the coming of a son, and sends it to Harold. And Harold immediately calls her and says, we need to talk. So Harold and his wife meet my mom and dad, and my mother tells Harold the whole story. And Harold is like blown away. He said, we always knew there was this mystery about the way that I was born, and nobody could tell us. As you can imagine, Harold and my mom have become quite close. Harold is an amazing human being, whom I love dearly. And one day, Harold and my mom are, and I didn't know Harold at this point, but my mom and Harold are talking, and a number of years later, and in this one conversation, my mother says, Harold, I have this son, and he wrote this book. And I'm having a problem with it. And Harold says, well, Bernice, why don't you let me read it and I'll tell you what I think. Oh, would you do that? So Harold Munn reads The Shack and he sends me an email. Hey, Paul, I read your book. Let me tell you, I love everything about this book. But I think I know what your mom's struggling with. It's the imagery that you use for God the Father. Let me see if I can do something about that. So Harold Munn blind copies me on an email to my mother. Dear Bernice, I read Paul's book. You need to know I love everything about this book, but I think I know what you're struggling with. It's the image that Paul uses, the imagery he uses for God the Father. Let me tell you why that imagery is so important to me. And Harold lays it out. We know God's not male or female. We know that all of maternity and all of paternity and all of masculinity and all of femininity is in the very nature of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Right? God's not like 51% male and 49% female, right? No. And imagery is all over the map in terms of Scripture. Think about it. God is masculine, father. God is feminine, woman who loses a coin, nursing mother in Isaiah. Right? God is a rock and a shield. A mother hen who covers the chicks. I tell people, well, I suppose I could have had Papa come through the door as a big hen, but I just don't know if it would have done. But you know God's not a rock. It's imagery, but you understand if somebody says God's a rock or a strong tower or a shield, you know, a lion, a lamb. We know this is imagery. Because how do we begin to understand facets of the character and nature of God if we don't have some way to grasp it? And this is why icons are windows through which to see. Not, you don't worship the icon, right? Well, we don't worship the imagery. It's to tell us something about the character and nature of God. And that's why it's going to take zillions of different ways of imagery to begin to ask. This is why it takes billions of people. Because every single person is a pixel that's in the portrait of the face of Jesus. Right? And it takes billions of unique persons. Each one of them is significant and essential to that face, to that picture. Right? look, in this room you have all these, this different imagery of the character and nature of God, because you're created in the image of God. You, your uniqueness, this is why you finding out what your voice is and who you are is so essential. If God wanted you to be someone else, he'd have made you someone else. Who you are matters. Now here's the beauty of the story. My mother saved a 1-pound little baby boy in 1946, who decades later becomes the man who is able to build a bridge that she can walk across for her own son. My mom loves the shack now. Doesn't understand it. But Harold loves it. How cool is that? Right? There you've got the weaving of a goodness of God. And I know this kind of weaving is going on all the time. And most of the time, we're not even present inside the grace of the day to even recognize it. We're off in some imagination that doesn't exist because we're freaked out. Because we don't know how to trust, so we're going to control. And the best way is to create an imagination, then freak out on everybody around us so that things we're afraid of don't happen. And then we miss what's going on right around us. Children, they see because they stay inside the presence. They stay in this place of the grace of one day. My mom entered nurse's training with one of her sisters, actually her only sister. She has four brothers and a sister. And her sister's name is Ruby, but she likes to be called Tess. So Ruby quit after a few months because she decided to become an educator, which is what she did. And Ruby, in my mother's German Baptist family, is the free spirit. She is the edgy one. She is the one that's out there somewhere, right? Cosmic vacuum cleaner, sort of sucking up the whole universe. And she's my favorite aunt, right? She took me to my first movie when it was totally against the rules. One of those things where you gotta hope to get out before Jesus comes back. And you know what it was? The King and I with Yul Brynner. I mean, you can see his whole bald head and everything. So Ruby lives in Victoria. And my mother's trying to lead her back to Jesus for like 50 years. And one night, my mother's down in Victoria visiting Ruby, and Ruby says, "Hey Bernice, let's go to church tomorrow. You want to go to church?" "Oh yeah. Where do you want to go?" She said, "I don't know." "Hey, let's go hear Harold, because Harold is the pastor of the Anglican Church, but they've never been to the Anglican Church." Now this is not like. This is semi-high Anglican church, right? This is where you have the, you know, I spoke there, I got to wear a dress, it was very cool. it's a very orderly kind of thing, it's beautiful, it's really cool. But they've never, you know, it's one of those places that you can spot people who don't know what they're doing, like immediately. So my mom and Ruby sneak into the back row, because this is all kind of new, and a woman slides in next to my mom because she immediately recognizes that these two women have no idea what they're doing. So she whispers to my mom, I'll help you, I'll tell you when to stand and sit and all this stuff. So halfway through the sermon, Harold spots my mom. Now this is long, narrow Anglican with the benches, you know, go all the way to the back. And pretty large place, but he spots her. And he stops. And he says, "Folks, I need to tell you a story." He says, "There's a woman here today. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be alive. In fact, every person that I've ever touched in my life, she has touched in and through me." And he tells his people about his birth. And then he goes back and finishes his sermon, and at the end of which they have communion at the front, right? Everybody comes up for communion. And the woman sitting next to my mom mistakenly says, "I'm so sorry, dear, but in our community, you have to be a member here to participate in communion." My mom's very gracious. It's like, oh, no problem. And it wasn't. It was like, I understand different faith cultures and what people, it's no problem. But at the end of which, when everybody has served communion, Harold takes off the outer vestments until he's wearing just white smock, and he walks over and picks up the bread and he picks up the cup. He walks down and he walks all the way back and kneels. He kneels in front of my mom and in front of Ruby. And in that moment, everything fades out, and you don't see agnostic or atheist or Anglican or Baptist, or you don't see any of that. You see everything is in a broken body and shed blood. This is what it all comes down to, right? This is our hope. This is our history. This is our being. Everything is in this broken body and shed blood. And I love that story. I love it on so many different levels. And because it was saying to Ruby, you're included. You're included. My first protesters,
you'll love this.
I was in Orlando, and I land, and I get escorted to the venue, which is like 2,000 people coming, or some massive crowd. And there's picketers with the bullhorns and the signs and the whole thing, and they've got their line, you know? And I'm thinking it's anti-abortion or something. And so I said, what are they protesting? And they go, well, you. I'm thinking, it wasn't long ago I was shipping out soldering tips and cleaning toilets, and I got protesters. Like, how cool is this? Right? I'm thinking, my kids are going to love this. So I got, it was like 100 degrees outside. They're working up a sweat, and it's sort of my fault. And so I got from the venue a case of water. And I'm out there, and I'm handing bottles of water to these guys. You know, they're yelling about this, violates the principles of God and all this. And so one of the guys, I hand him water, he goes, thanks. And he says, do you work here? And I go, no. He said, really? So why are you doing this? You know, like handing out water and stuff. I wrote the book you're mad about. What? You know, so... Instant crowd for 15 minutes, we're talking about it, and I come to find out not one of the protesters had read it. I'm going like, hey, you guys, why don't you come in? I mean, it's hot out here and stuff. Oh, no. You know, so I walk away, they're back on the bullhorns. Violates principles of God. I'm thinking, my people. You know, how cool is that? This is so interesting to be in the middle of this mix, and I'm thoroughly grateful. But I get just to talk about what I'm talking to you about. The love of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And the fact that they matter. And that they're included. You know how many times that they've never heard that? And we would have saved ourselves hundreds of years of just idiocy if when we went into a new place, we'd have just acknowledged that those people were already inside the affection and we could listen to them and learn. Rather than the kind of things that we have perpetrated. So I end up being this white guy, you know, Middle Ages. A lot of the damage in the world comes from my kind of guy, right? I'm like, all right, this is part of what I have to, you know? This is part of what I get to ask forgiveness for, is what we've done to the women, what we've done to the children, what we've done to the First Nations people, what we've done to the African American community, what we've done to the Africans, and how we've shipped. We're now getting people coming in from the developing world, the emerging world, full of the lies that we shipped out all over the world in the name of Jesus. You know, and it's not that we haven't done some beautiful and wonderful, creative, good things, because we have. Whether it's medicine or education or working against poverty and all that kind of stuff. But we've also perpetrated an awful lot. And there's a lot to ask for forgiveness for. Okay, the question is about writing the shack and how much did I feel like it was Holy Spirit inspired and all that. By the time I wrote it, I was at the place in my understanding and my relationship with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that it was not about being used of God. because I come from a sexual abuse history, I'm not about to be used by anybody. Right? And I think that kind of language is fundamentally wrong. This is not a God who uses anybody. God doesn't heal you because he wants to use you. He heals you because he loves you. And then he invites you to play. So the language of play and participation is way better for me. And I think we've got to move. I don't think anybody is a tool, because you don't have a relationship with tools. I'm talking to an artist going like, so, you got kind of a thing going with your brush? You know, it's like, are you nuts? Exactly, see? But we talk about God, I'm a tool. Like, come on. You think that little of God, that he's out there trying to use people and turn them into tools. You know, you're the one he loves. It's not about what you're going to do for him. You think he needs that? God doesn't need anything. So this is about our participation and play as children. We get to participate. So I didn't write the book by myself. But God didn't write it by himself either. And I understand that a lot of us come from a basis of shame, and we're so terrified that if we offer anything, somebody's going to criticize it and it's going to kill us. Okay? And so we're so shame-based, we're afraid to finish something, you know, because procrastination is to keep something from being at a place where it can be judged. That's one of the reasons why procrastination happens, is because we don't want to actually finish something, because then they can tell me it sucks, right? So there's all these elements going on. How many times have people said, well, this song, the Lord gave me this song. You know, and you know what they're doing? They're trying to get out of a firing squad. The Lord gave me the song, and you listen to it and you go like, you're thinking, God writes such terrible songs. Right? But when my grandchild brings me this theme with all these colors and vague shapes, and they're going like, Grandpa, it's the most beautiful piece of art I have ever seen in my life. Because it's them that I care about. And they created this and thought, I'll give this to Grandpa. Right? So when people come with their creativity, there's mistakes in Shaq, so I know I participated. I'm serious, right? It's not like another Bible or something. You want me to tell you about Abraham and Isaac just as a closure? That was the passage that dominated Christian missions for a long time. You got to be willing to sacrifice your child on the altar of God's purposes and services and all that kind of stuff. And I was always told, you know, either Abram at the time, didn't understand his own heart, and so God's putting him to a test, or God doesn't understand Abram's heart and putting him to a test. So this is the test. Am I a priority in your life? Right? Am I number one? Because I'm gonna ask you to give up what you think is number one just to prove to me, or to prove to yourself, depending on how you look at God in this story, that I'm number one. And that's kind of how we see that whole story. So here's the other narrative, which I think is the right one. And it makes way more sense to me. On a scale from A to Z, just a made-up scale, but just say on A to Z, where would you put Abram in terms of his spiritual development at this point? So you're going to have Abram maybe with a foot in A and a foot in B, okay. Right? Because in Ur of the Chaldees, there's no seminary, there's no Bible school, there are no churches, there is no nothing. There is a moon worshipper's temple, the Nanu and Ningal, right? And Abram, being a good religious person, would have worshipped there. Now, the reason he's not totally an A, he's got a foot somewhere else, is because he hears voices. Right? So he is like, oh my gosh, there's a voice, right? And it's telling me, get out of town. A, B, right? He's in there somewhere. Enough that he's going to get out of town. And you remember, he drags all of his gods and stuff with him because everything's territorial in his mind. He doesn't know about Jesus. He doesn't know anything. He's got no education, no theological education, right? No frame of reference. He's A to B. Now, the beauty of God is that God doesn't, when I'm in B, he doesn't show up in like Q, going like, Paul, what is your problem? Because frankly, when I'm in A and B, Q doesn't exist, you know? When I get to B, I'm going to think, People in C are nuts, and people in A are idiots. Because that's what people in B do. We build a church right here. And we think, C, are you kidding? You are nuts. Like they're insane. You guys are just idiots. Because if you weren't idiots, you'd be here in B. Right? Because we think B is Z. We think it's not a scale. It goes from A to Z, and we're at Z. Right? You understand how much we do this. Right? So, God comes and says, where does God come? If I'm in B, God's going to come with 1 foot in C and 1 foot in B. And he's going to be going like, come on, Paul. Come on. I know this is really painful for you, but I'm going to introduce you to C. And then we're going to move from there. Right? And this is going to take a while to get you out of B. This is the beauty of how God works with us. Abraham is moving. And a lot of times in the Old Testament stories, when you're, the Hebrew scriptures, when you're looking at this, God is revealing his character and nature incrementally through this process. You understand? And so what God does is he says, come here, I want to tell you something new that you didn't know about me, and I'm going to tell you this, and I'm going to attach a name to it so that you can now refer to me as this. And a lot of times it just kind of whips by you the fact that God says, and my name is, bam, and it's a new name. Well, guess what? This story has a new name in it. So here's the problem. We read this story, and we're thinking, what is Abram's problem? God's telling him to sacrifice his son. You know what I'd say? No. Serious. Abram doesn't seem to have a problem with it. Right? And if you read Hebrews, which is kind of the backstory, it says that Abram either figures out, this is his calculation, well, God promised me a son, so either he's going to give me a new one, or he's going to raise this one from the dead. Those are his, like his, but he doesn't go, what are you talking about sacrificing my son? That is just nuts. No. If you're healthy as a human being, you'd be going like, are you crazy? I'm not going to do that. So, what is God doing? All right? Abram, I want you to sacrifice your son. What does Abraham say? Okay. Why does Abraham say okay? Because every religion on the planet is about appeasement theology. So if God's going to come and talk our language so that we can begin to work our way out of it, he's going to come talk to us appeasement language, because that's the only one we know. You're going to require, what is the prophets when they show up? You think God requires sacrifice? This God doesn't require sacrifice. Right? What does Daniel say? There'll come a time when the Messiah comes, he will put an end to sacrifice. Right? But it's our language. We've done something wrong. Somebody's got to pay. We're going to pay this so that our crops are good, or whatever, 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 whatever. It's all appeasement theology. And that doesn't matter where on the planet you go at this time. You go down to the Incan civilization in South America. You go to Africa. You go to anywhere. Egypt. Anywhere, it's appeasement theology. So God comes and finds our love language. Appeasement. And he says, every one of these religions, the greatest sacrifice is what? Child sacrifice. Because it's the most pure and the most, right? It's at the top of the, right now, our little grandbaby's from Uganda, but right now for $80 US, you can buy a child in Uganda, and the witch doctor will cut that child up and put that child in the corner of buildings to sacrifice that child to the local spirits so that those businesses thrive. Right now. That's part of our darkness that we brought to the table. Well, God comes in and says, sacrifice your child. Abram says, okay. Off they go. The knife is coming down, and God says, stop. This is really early in Abram's journey of understanding the character and nature of God. And what does God say to him? Abram, I want you to understand this about me. I do not require child sacrifice. If I need a sacrifice, I will provide myself. What it says. Jehovah Jireh, first time is used, the God who will provide himself. But you still speak appeasement, so here's a ram. Right? Look at this story now. This is not about God requiring us to sacrifice our children. Your desire to protect your child, that originates in the father heart of God. You're not opposed to God with some kind of, well, I really love my children, so I must be in some kind of conflict with the character and nature of God in terms of God's heart. You're not. That desire to protect and embrace, and your desire that your child will grow up to be everything that he or she was created to be, that originates not in you, it originates in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he's not going to put you in conflict with that, but he's got to deal with our darkness, so he comes to speak our language so that he can get rid of it. Which happens when we then sacrifice the ultimate lamb, Jesus. And he puts an end to sacrifice. But that's way down there. And Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the A to Z. Right? This is why it's about our relationship and what we hear in terms of that relationship. Again, to the praise of his glory. The revelation of his character and nature in the face of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You're looking for the answer. I've only got one. That a man leaves his darkness when he follows the sun.